Okay, so this is apparently the biggest crowd in Miami this morning anywhere. Monday morning in Miami is very challenging, but I'm delighted that you all came out for this. It's going to be a really interesting hour. And we've got with us our good friend from Boston Scientific, Mauricio Ortiz, and his team. But first of all, I'm just going to remind you, if I may, what's coming up soon, so that you can log these in your diary, your mental calendar, if you wish. So we have the chairman and CEO of Vanguard on February the 20th. We have the president of the American Red Cross on March 22nd. We have Larry Summers on April the 10th. We have the founder of urgent care clinics in the United States on May the 3rd. And then we have our own Alex Villa in September from the Miami Herald Media Company. So we've got a great lineup of people. We've got others in the works. But most importantly, this morning, we're here to introduce Mauricio, who, as I've already said, is really a great friend of the school. And he and Boston Scientific have been really long-time loyal supporters of many of our activities, both to benefit students and to benefit executive education operations here, as well as faculty engagement also. So I want to thank Mauricio for all of your contributions. And I'll invite you now to come up, introduce your team, and tell us what happened in Puerto Rico. Okay, thank you very much.
Wow, yes, it's a lot of people. So, good morning. I will be very short my introduction. I will do it after the beginning that we will start right now.
Thank you. So I got groups of 20 people outside trying to help. At the time went by, we had groups to help probably 25, 30, 40 people. They came in just to help us. But they still show up for the shift. So they basically came in. We meet each other. I asked them, you know, how did you go with your family? And they just were like, yeah, we lost everything. But I'm here to help. I'm going to get this place back on because this is the second family. This is a work journey. I need to get it. I can only fit with a number of people who were here already. It was very encouraging to know that the principles on their minds that they wanted to get to the plant and try and secure the facility.
Everyone right has to do user creativity to overcome the challenges that we were having at that time to make sure we continue laboring on the ground and that we establish operations.
The city is supposed to be creative, but I'm not going to be able
to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. Para producir si no saben que son empleados y no se pueden cuidar bien. Y si se necesita poner en el aire,
it costs so much about production that there are thousands of people who need to get their jobs now for the
but in spirit of making sure the patient comes first, we talk about the bullseye and the center of the bullseye is patient care and making sure that we were getting every unit out of the site that we possibly could to support our patients around the world. And we thought all other avenues were shut down.
I think that this company is probably the best example of how having a strong corporate culture and living the beliefs they have and living the values that they have can really impact or potentially save someone's life to the point that, you know, we're relying on Boston Scientific to give us clean drinking water. And they're doing so many things just to alleviate the burdens that the employees have experienced because of the storms.
We will not be able to live while we have Puerto going above of what was the expectation. Really, it's because of the people that were here. Thanks for your support. And thanks for the culture that you have created in our company.
With all my heart, with the help of my family and the family of the people who work on this organization. Thank you.
Thank you for being there for us.
Gracias.
Thank you for being there for us.
So, gracias por estar ahí para nosotros.
Thanks for being there for us.
Gracias por estar ahí.
Thank you for being there for us.
Gracias por estar ahí.
Boston Scientific, gracias por estar ahí para nosotros.
I've been in this auditorium seated a lot of times. I know the caliber of people that you bring here. I'm very glad to be close to being this Sir Martin's forum for the people that I have heard here. And so I just hope that we can share our experiences in Puerto Rico and that you don't regret inviting us. So, Puerto Rico was hit September 20th, with the worst hurricane in the last 80 years. September 21 was sharing breakfast in the faculty with Dean John and others. And we were talking very interesting things about how to bring a culture of health to the companies. And while he was doing a great presentation, a really intelligent one, he saw probably that I looked at my phone a couple of times, and at one moment I had to step out. So I came back, and he said, "Is everything okay?" I said, "Well, we're in the middle of a crisis, and this crisis is we have our people in Puerto Rico, more than 1,000 employees, and by the way, a manufacturing plant that, as you will see later, is crucial, probably for the health of the world." So we were talking about that. I said, "Hey, Mauricio, when this ends, I would like to know the results." So this is what we're delivering today, is the results on a crisis. The most important thing is, just imagine for one moment that we're sitting here in this auditorium, and let's picture this auditorium tomorrow being a place full of children going around and being a healthcare, let's say, facility, where we have families sitting around here, lunch being served there, a booth for a woman to feed their children, and that will happen in one single day. That's exactly what happened in our offices in our manufacturing plant. We had to change the way we operate to bring people and families. We had more than 100 people that lose completely their homes, bring shelter, bring water, a lot of things. But just imagine that it was nothing was like the day before. To do that, I'm sure you have all done this. You have, the first thing is to have somebody that takes the lead, somebody that says, "Let's transform this, go out, let's bring things here, let's bring water, let's make some communication to bring wise people from every place." And that's one of the lessons learned that I want to talk a little bit before I introduce my team. In order to manage a crisis like we got in Puerto Rico, you need to have a team. You need to have a leadership team. You need to have somebody that gets in charge and takes the responsibility. Fortunately for us, we had a little bit of a warm-up in management crisis when we had Irma hitting Miami. And we had, I appointed a crisis management team so that they could come up and manage our Western employees. Then we had, 2 days before this crisis, we had the earthquake in Mexico. So we also had to assemble a crisis management team. And when we had the problem or Maria coming, I made the call to assemble a crisis management team. And when I made this call, the people that are here had already started their own crisis management team. So they never got a call from me to say, "Guys, we need to start a crisis management team." And these guys were not part either from Irma or from Mexico. And when I asked them, "Why would you want to do this?" they said, "Because I think we owe the people that have been taking care of us to take now the responsibility for the guys in Puerto Rico." So, I didn't tell you, never, what was the call about. And I will tell you today what the call was about. So I received a call from the executive committee and the CEO, where they ask was, "Hey, Mauricio, how are you doing? How's Puerto Rico doing?" I said, "We're good." And he said, "Who's handling this? Did you appoint somebody?" And I said, "No." And then there was a long silence from CEOs are not good. And so he said, So I said, I don't have a team. I have a team that volunteered. I said, briefly, talk to me about that team. And I said, well, first, this team is Latin. And I said, Latin America teams know how crisis looks like. Latin America is a complete crisis every day. So these guys know how to, when the customs close, when there are no airports, when there are chiefs of government. And they absolutely know that in Latin America, they say that even the past is unpredictable. So these guys will know what to do and how to do it. So I said, I think that's the most important part. I said, but the second part from the experience of managing crisis is these people are very good at managing themselves and will manage what we call today emotional intelligence. When you go through crisis, through big crisis like this with management, there are a lot of feelings in the room. You have fear. You go to joy. You get surprises. You feel anger. You have a lot of emotions. You go from laugh to crying really fast. We did laugh with this team a lot, making really stupid things. And we cried also when we saw how the impact we have been having in our people. So with that, I said, hey, Mike, they're Latin. They have emotional intelligence, but most of all, they breathe our corporate values. They understand the mission. Our mission, Boston Scientific, is we make money, but it's not the mission. We are not money makers. We treat patients. We save lives. It's in our DNA. And if we do that right, and we know what is the objective, I only had these guys on the phone for 5 minutes. I told them, you know where the objectives are, right? And they said, yeah, of course. The first one will be take care of our people. If not, we will never reach our patients. Second, continue to save lives and have all the patients in Puerto Rico treated. Third, go back to production. And with that, things will go seamless. That was the task they received. And fortunately, in the company, we do some drills, but for fun, when we teach our employees in our advanced leadership and management teams, we teach them, and we have used a couple of examples. For example, I always put teams to work on what happened in a plane crashes in one of our manufacturing sites. And the other, what will happen if hackers come in and hack our system. So that's probably a little bit on our DNA. But what I want to share with you today, and the team wants to share with you today, we are not crisis management experts. We are far from giving a class or a lecture on crisis management. But we will share with you what we did and what was the impact of what we did. And one thing that I'm very proud of is there are a lot of bigger companies than us in the island. A lot of very, very big companies that we had the opportunity to influence, and we were not only able to touch the Boston Scientific families that we estimate in 1,500 employees times 3, probably about 5,000 people, but we were able with our actions to get other companies, bigger companies, to imitate what we were doing. And things like today, one of the things that we are more very proud of is we have had no attrition and nobody has left the companies. And by the way, we receive every day more resumes for people that want to work in the company. So, Maria, that's sitting on her right, Maria is a person that started this management crisis. And Maria was our former vice president of Brazil, so she has been the head of our biggest operation in Latin America. So she pretty much, if you live in Brazil, you pretty much know how to manage some crisis. And Juan, Felipe has been our head, also country director in Colombia. And he was also country director in Puerto Rico. So when people were looking at maps, and where people were looking at the island, the only person that really knew what it is, the places where it was, and from Felipe. So I always tell out to my classroom where you invite me. I say, what is what I value the most? And the students, I say, I value the most the ordinary people that can do extraordinary things. And that's what these people will tell you, and how we manage the crisis, how did we went from a complete disorder to a complete organized, not organized disorder, but almost. But how, I'm very proud to share with you that we did. We were the first company that could say, and we made it the first company in the other fundamental devices to go back to normal. And the fortune was that this team, when they volunteered, they did it because they really like what they do, but they also knew that failure was not an option, so no pressure. But they knew that if we went back to business, definitely we would lose some lives. So with that said, let me get Maria to the stage to get started.
Mauricio was saying, we had just gotten back to our office in Weston the one day before the Wednesday that the storm hit, because our office had been closed because of Irma. And when we all connected and we saw the magnitude, and like most of your companies, as well as the school, you know, that we live here in Florida, we do have emergency preparedness before, you know. Our payroll was set up beforehand. We had our financial systems okay, fine. You know, we had a telephone tree set up. But as we always say, you don't know what you don't know. And it was the magnitude and the impact that this storm had. So that one day in our offices, you know, we reached out to each other. We said, I won't use the bad word, but I'll say, heck, that's going to be a big storm. So we said to Mauricio, we better do what they did for us with Irma and put together a team outside of the crisis to manage through this. When we finished that one, is a Mauricio to call corporate, because we also have to link up with the Dorado plant. And this gives you an idea of how many employees and where they're located. Among the most scientific employees, it's almost 1,100 employees on the island. This is the path that Maria took. And these are our two facilities. We've got on the top the Dorado plant and our commercial offices. And I linked up with corporate manufacturing. Also had done the preparedness of getting assets off the island, fell from a tree. But again, you don't realize the immensity until the night of Tuesday or Wednesday, when most of us in the Western office did not sleep as we were tracking the storm with the telephone tree and lights up and people that we were talking to on the island, and there was total communication. We knew that the telephone communication and the infrastructure was also already hard on the island, but all the cell towers went down, so we were in the black for a while. Then we're watching the news, and the Hurricane Center said that all their towers went down as well, so for a while we couldn't even track the storm. So that's why when we started the presentation, it was just kind of connected the dots and remind us of what that was like when we went through it. That visual, that flag, the island of Puerto Rico is actually the size of Puerto Rico outside the size of that storm. I felt I was in a made for TV movie for a while, that, you know, perfect storm, all of the things that could have underlined that affected us. What we wanted to share with you guys and do it again, you know, more like a conversation, is the response that we did for the manufacturing of Mauricio. So that manufacturing plant is fairly important for us. There are 50-plus life science plants, manufacturing facilities in Puerto Rico. It accounts for about 70% of the Puerto Rican exports. It accounts for about 25% of U.S. exports for drug and medical devices. So it was a major, major deal for the island for manufacturing. And then also Felipe will talk to what we did to the response for our people and our patients. Professor Sharma, see how formal I am with you, being formal like this, constantly. He knows that we deal with all the stakeholders. our five P's and R's within the ecosystem of healthcare. So we'll really be able to talk about what we did from the commercial side in trying to get back to helping our customers and helping our patients. And then we'll kind of go through lessons learned. So the plant, so you saw that picture before, we're talking a little bit over 1,000 employees. It's a very large plant that works 24-7. So what Mauricio was saying, this is the one plant within Boston Scientific's infrastructure of plants that manufactures the leads, which are that will connect our pacemakers and defibrillators. So impacting the sourcing of this plant would have been a major big deal for Boston Scientific globally. So making sure that infrastructure was safe, and we had made it hurricane ready, but making sure that it was up and running was going to be a major issue for us. Everyone within Boston Scientific has the patient first. Whether you're doing R&D, whether you're doing manufacturing, whether you're in sales, like our organization is, our patients come first. That plant manufactures a little over 400,000 leads a year. And that impacts, if you look at the bottom, one patient per minute across the globe. So if we had not gotten that plant up and running, we would have had a major impact on the patients with whom we deal with and the care that we can provide. So when Mauricio referred to failure as not an option, I was at the moment of the lead man, and I were the crisis management team point for Weston. And we worked very closely with our corporate crisis management team, and it involved even members of our executive committee. And we kind of assumed this the same, because as most of you know, this mission was a mission that did not get to the moon. But it's the famous Houston, we have a problem. It was making sure that we got everybody back alive. So for us, it was failure was not an option. It's something we took very, very much to heart. From a manufacturing perspective, just so that you guys see there, we touched on employee safety was our number one. Not only did we have telephone trees to access employees, we had to go to the airways. I was talking to Nancy sometimes. If you don't have telephones, you can always use internet. You can always use WhatsApp. You know, you've got other availability of stuff. We had nothing, you know, so we were up with communications to the mainland by Monday, so we ended up setting down satellite phones, so we had some satellite phones, but there's also some funny stories with satellite phones, like they don't work inside, you know, so there are things, there are learnings all throughout this management of the crises, but we for us, getting in communications, we went to the radio stations, we were using social media, sometimes social media outside of the United States. We were triangulating our securities folks. But, you know, I always think, well, they somehow in our sleep must have inserted a GPS chip because our securities folks could tell us who may have been accounted for, who had not been accounted for. So we kind of triangulated that. But with 1,000 employees and some of them pretty far from the plant, you can only imagine it took about 10 days to get a hold of everybody, about 2 weeks before we had a final countdown on all of our employees and making sure that they were safe. Data communications, we actually had at one point plan A, plan B, plan C. We sent satellite dishes down. We had two lines that we were trying to set up. We actually sent experts down to help us with our communications. As far as the cell towers, we actually contracted and put up poles to make sure that we had some reception the second week when we were there. As far as the employee basic needs, to what Mauricio was saying, at the plant as well as in our commercial office, we had daycare, we turned conference rooms so that people could bring in their kids. We set up beauty shops, we set up barber shops, we had dry cleaning, people could wash their clothes. You know, so we had to think of all of these basic needs, because if we didn't take care of our folks, we couldn't take care of our patients. And the company was just immense in helping us. I mean, our CEO gave us a corporate jet for two weeks, and corporate jet was down here in Fort Lauderdale, shutting stuff down there, because although we rely on UPS, and we're one of UPS's major customers, they couldn't fly into the airport. The airport had no electricity for a while. We didn't have radar. So you really had to really think outside of the box and trying to help what we had in mind. As far as transportation was chaos. Anybody who is on the island knows that they could not connect from the north of the island to the south of the island for a while. That hindered our ability to locate our employees, but people of their own volition went out, you know, looking for people, visiting people's homes. So there was a lot there. Diesel, for a while, you were listening to the news reports, you were hearing that there was no diesel on the island. There was diesel on the island, but gas stations had no electricity, so nobody could pump it. Or they were sitting on a tank at the ports, and the ports didn't have electricity, and workers were taking care of their own homes, so they weren't there to unload it. So it's all these things that when you take a crisis management plan, you know, class, or when you go through it, what are the things that you need to make sure you have? Okay, diesel, we got this, but you don't know what you don't know. So that was a lot of what we went through. Water, the company supplied for a good 2 months over 17,000 gallons of water to our employees. And there are still parts of the island that do not have drinkable water. So it's something that, you know, basic need, we were there. Supplier recovery. Like I said, we're one of UPS's biggest customers. When we went to do use UPS, or like, first of all, FEMA has us now for anything that is, you know, medical emergency for Puerto Rico. You know, your stuff is considered medical, but there was probably a 2 week lag before UPS was up and running at 100%. We were using FedEx. Suppliers on the island that took a hit, you know, for our boxing. We had to work with them, actually work with them to help them get up and running. The Employee Relief Fund, Boston Scientific immediately set aside $2 million of all the employees globally, about $500,000 was actually collected. And our CEO actually visited Puerto Rico with us the Monday before Thanksgiving. And one of the things that we saw was that two things. First of all, there's a lot of pride on that island, so a lot of people, despite having lost everything, did not want to apply for the funds because they were afraid that someone needed it more. So people weren't applying for that fund. And secondly, there was the how do we get it to them, like the cash issue. There were so many things that were an impediment, just the day-to-day. So our CEO on the spot made a decision, okay, whoever applies to the fund is there. But we're hitting Thanksgiving and the holidays. So he made a decision to give us back $2,000 to every employee the Boston Scientific had on the island, in addition to the fund that was set up to help them through some of the hardships from an immediate perspective. And personal sacrifice the day after, and I'll talk about that picture, which you can't see really well, but that guy, his name is Ryan Diaz, and we call him Superman. The day after the storm hit, 60 of our plant employees showed up at the plant, even though their houses were in complete destruction. The next day, about 150 people showed up, and people just kept continuing to show up to make sure that the plant was secure, to make sure that we needed to do whatever we needed to do to get it up and running. In the middle of the storm, actually, when the eye was passing through, Superman, who was really close to the plant, and we all agreed to say things. And in that picture, you actually see Mike Maloney, our CEO, and our head of VP, Wendy Carruthers, giving him a recognition because eye of the storm was coming by. The winds were still at about 120, 130, and he went up on the roof of the plant where our cleaning rooms are, tethered himself to go out there, and there was about 2 feet of water on our roof, and he actually, by himself, actually drained that part of the roof. If not, our roof would have caved in, and that would have put our plant totally out of commission after the storm. So we actually recognized Superman because of what he did and taking the risks that he did. But there were so many stories of people and the personal sacrifice, despite everything that they were going through, that was also a learning for us. So we were actually operational, as Mauricio said, by day three, not at 100%, but we were actually producing. And we were close to 100% operational for the second week after the storm. We were actually sending out product as well as receiving raw materials by that second week. We were the first plant that was up and running. And our global demand and supply chain for the leads that are producing that plant were not affected, so we actually thought that we met our objective, and that was a great success story. When our CEO came down the Monday before Thanksgiving, Boston Scientific, one of our values is winning spirit, and on a quarterly basis, gives out this winning spirit award. And I got a call from corporate, and it was, I got a call like on October 1st, and were saying the submission for the winning spirit is like the public term. You know, we're still on the throes of this. He goes, can you prepare, you know, like every good company, nothing gets done without a document, and you know, you have to prepare, and how many people were affected, what did they do, examples of every value so they could win the winning spirit. So we actually submitted that jointly with the manufacturing plant. And when Mike Maloney came down, we did Maggie, with Joe Fitzgerald, with like three of the AC members, it was to give both the plant employees and our commercial employees the winning spirit award because of how they had reacted and everything that they had done throughout this, this storm. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Walter. He's going to go through everything we did from a patient perspective.
Thank you, Marianne. Can I have it? I kind of prefer to be here. So the second thing that we will do after we have this manufacturing work is we, in real time, we start working with our people, the benefit for our patients. So you can imagine, we are in charge of providing attention to 3.5 million potential customers in the island with 56 people that we have in our offices. So, we are in charge to let the hospitals and physicians have the products and the service that they require to provide health. But also, we have some special duty as well for some of the divisions that we have. So we provide some ongoing assistance to the patients, especially the ones who have problems with the cardiac rhythm management. So, if they have pacemakers, defibrillators, or nervous stimulators, they need to have a periodic revision and programming of their devices. And we do this with these 56 people. So, we have a tremendous pressure of duty for our patients, our physicians, and our hospitals. So, every year, we treat 110,000 patients in the island. So if you expand this to the family, an average of four, probably we have 500,000 people that we are touching every year in the island, in an island of 3.5 million people. So that's a lot of people that can be beneficiary now for what we do. So by day three, we were doing cases again for patients that really need emergency care in the hospitals that were possible to do that. Because once we have the heat of Maria, all hospital collapse. Because of or they have a lot of patients, either emergency rooms or because they didn't have the way to provide the right attention, especially some of the patients that has been programmed in advance. So they were basically operating in emergency mode. But by day three, we were able to start doing cases again. And there was one anecdote of one of the guys that showed up at 7 a.m. right exactly the day after Maria hit the island in the hospital where he had some scheduled program surgery to provide the service. And he showed up in the hospital. Obviously, the hospital was not in capacity of providing the help. Obviously, the patient didn't come up, but he was there. So this showed the commitment of the people in many cases running away of their own tragedy at home, trying to help other people in that are in need. So this clinical support is 24/7. So these people is on call every day of the year, every minute of the year. So we are there for our patients. So what we did for our employees first, we start what we call the accountability phone call tree. It means that we assign people that were outside of the island. We provide an average between 7 and 10 people to reach by phone and be accountable for before, in, and after the hurricane hit. So this lets us know which people are accountable or not. And if some people were missing in the process, those people were already with an extra effort in the point that we can locate them. So we established this, and this, we started with the problem with Irma, we did this with the earthquake in Mexico, and finally we did a great job with Maria when Maria hit Puerto Rico, because very fast we were able to account the 100% of the people in the island, even some of them that were in the remote locations and were not possible to locate them. We were able to get in touch with them in a week, so it was really soon. And let me explain you why and how we did it. So when you when a tragedy hit, you think that you can count with some basic things like connectivity, that phone calls, etc. But let me tell you, it didn't work. We have some areas in Ponce and in Mayagüez, in the south of the island, but we didn't have communication by land because we have a bridge that really fell down. We didn't have telephone because the powers were falling, so we didn't have a way to communicate with them. So even we saw some of our people writing post-its in the blackboard in the hospital saying, in this case, it was one of the guys that is in the side, I will tell you the name in a minute. And he said, I'm Roberto Rizzo. I am fine. My family is fine. I'm working in this address. This is my home. If you need me, go to see me. So in this way, we start locating some people because it was the basic thing. How do you locate yourself if you don't have a telephone, if you don't have any other way to communicate? So you need to give messages. So the other thing that we try to do is how we keep our people up and running if they don't have the basic things in their homes for them and for their families. So very quickly we realized water and electricity was top priorities for us. So we decided to send some portable power plants to each employee. So we very fast wanted to do that. But guess what? Tried to acquire 60 portable power plants overnight. It's difficult. When you show up in a store, probably they have 8, they have 10. So we found a place where we can find 60 power plants. But it's not only to send the power plants. You need also gas and fuel to do that. So you need the proper tanks to carry this fuel as well. But also, all that we that have used a power plant, you know that you can use. You can't use the power plant inside of your home because you are going to die with the monoxide of carbon that is released by the plant. So you need also to provide some long power cords for the people to be able to use it. But if you don't think everything, because if you don't think of this, you send the power plants, but they can reuse it. So all these details are in real time being decided when we were managing this, because by day 3, they already have the power plant in their hands once we were able to find a plane to ship these materials. So we use the jet, the executive jet, to bring water, to bring some medicines, to bring baby food, and to bring some of the things that are basic materials that we can bring them. But also, more importantly, we brought some satellite phones. Because if all the network or phones were down, the only way to communicate with them is using the satellite phones. So, but you start with things. You think, yes, send the satellite phones, but who knows how to handle a satellite phone, how to use it? This requires some special training. So we were trained on this live also, and we communicate and we replicate this with the people in the island about how to use them. But also, if you cannot reach the people that is missing, in this case, the ones who were in the south and in the east of the compound of the island, you need to send them in other ways. So in this case, we use motorcycles because for cars, it was almost impossible to reach the south of the island. So with this satellite phone, we were able to establish communication because the calls were completely random. People were driving around in the island looking for the hotspots when they can have signal in their phones to make the calls. But in the moment that they were doing this, they were also exhausting the gas that they have because there were not more gas in the island, as Maria said, because the gas station didn't have power to fill because the pumps didn't work. So it was a complete mess. So we also provide water to the employees. Initially, we fill a plane with water when we start delivering the water. Later, we realized that there was some water in the island, especially in some places that usually have higher stocks, but they can't use it, like in the case of hotels that were not capable to receive customers. But they have the inventory of water. They have the water in the warehouse, but they cannot receive any people. So we acquired this water, and we continue supplying from this water to our office. So imagine in a place where you don't have ATH, you have ATMs, you don't have banks because the power line is down. So how do you pay for basic things when you find it? For groceries or for bread or for coffee or for what you need? You need to have cash. So if you don't have ATMs, your cash is going to be exhausted very quickly. So what we realized as well is that we need to provide some cash to the employees in order for them to acquire what they need. So we call the company, and we said, yeah, we need $10,000 in cash. We need to tell them, say, yes, probably a week you will have it because we need some signatures. And I say, why in the heck if Mauricio is in power of sign up to several $1 million in business, we cannot have $10,000 in cash now because we need it now. And finally, they fix it. And we call to the bank, to the branch that is close to our office, and they say, yes, you can come from the money right now. We say, okay, and what, how are the bills? Yeah, $100 bills. We have everything done. I say, come on. We cannot show up with $100 bills. Imagine you are trying to buy some oranges with $100 bill in a place where no one has cash or no one has nothing. So you are going to be rejected immediately. Who received $100 bill in Miami? No one. So we need to call them back and say, no, we cannot accept these $100 bills. We need $20 bill or less. That's the way that we need the money. So, but these kind of things happen in real time. So, we didn't send the $100 bills and they go back and change it. No, I mean, we need to solve this in this moment. So, when we reached them with the money, people were really, really thankful. It was a loan that we did for them, but they feel like they really relaxed because in this moment they feel again in power of their own lives. Because imagine you have the money in your bank. You have money in your bank. Even because we did the payroll up before the hurricane hit, and it was in the account council of all the employees. But they didn't have access. They didn't have access to the money. So in the moment that they have the cash in their pockets, they feel again that they can do their normal life. So the thing that we did is with some influence that we have, we were able to convince some gas stations that we were entitled to have some privilege in order to fill our tanks because we were doing health care for the population. So they graciously accept that we, in these long lines, because the line were 4, 5, 6 miles line to fill the tanks, the portable tanks or the car tanks, and we were able to bypass all this line and have the gas that we need in order to provide better service for the patients. But we did it because the people understood what is the role that we were doing in this situation. Also, we established a laundry service. We reached an agreement. It was 3-4 days after the hurricane. We reached an agreement with a laundry service seen all the dirty clothes to them. They cleaned it for them, and they picked them up, and we, in this way, we were able to have all the people really thinking in patience and really thinking in help rather than spending their time in doing their own errands. Also, as Maria mentioned, we have in-house daycare. These 56 employees multiplied by three or by four. So in our offices, it was a bunch of people. It was really funny because they were playing soccer in the aisles. They were drawing. They were doing many things. But all the kids, all the people were there in our office. Meanwhile, the people were enjoying some of the fresh air condition that was there, the water and the nice restroom, etc. Because one of the things that we're immediately communicating to the people is that due to the high level of water that they have in the island, it was not allowed for the people to use their bathrooms and to all the sewage system, in other words, were collapsing. So they were afraid that it was going to be fond of diseases and cholera and other things. So they feel that they can use, they cannot use the bathroom. So they were in the office and they were really having a more comfortable stay. Also established in within a week individual and group psychological help. It's really hard for the ones who are in this situation. They feel that they are not in control of their life. So this is something that really helped the people to express the sense of loss. Many people lost their home. Many people lost their property because they need to evacuate the places. And when they came back, they didn't find their things because they were robbed. So many people were really suffering with all of this. So this psychological support helped them a lot to establish and regain the peace and the psychological well. In Boston Scientific, with the help of the company and with the support of the employees also, we create a fund to help the people. And it was funny because people didn't want it to use this fund. And after 3 or 4 weeks, we were asking why people are not claiming this money. They know they have this money. Why do they not have it? And we realized that they were waiting to be claimed by the people that were in worse condition than them. In other words, they felt that there were other people that have more problems, and they were not using this money. Obviously, we need to encourage all of them to use them for the reconstruction and everything. But this is something interesting about how people feel this solidarity with the rest of the people. We have also how to claim to FEMA about the damages, and we ask our lawyers to help them do the right work and to have this money coming from FEMA flowing in benefits for the communities and their families. So also we provide full working special flexibility. All the people really were doing their job. I mean we basically opened the schedule and people were working from home, the ones that were working from home, and some of them were working from the office, etc. So after 3 days, we were able to have 100% of the people working, attending the hospital and seeing patients with the support that we provide. So what we did, this is what we did for our people. Now we did what we did as a company. It was very interesting as well because imagine that we as a company, we have our duties to provide products to the hospitals in order for them to treat the patients. So we had daily calls when we were assessing what were the needs of the company, what kind of products, what kind of things they need, and we were able to ship many of the products, initial shipments in our corporate jet. It was basically used to handle the problems that were more urgent for the patients and for the hospitals. When a business continuity plan is in action before, during, and after the storm, this is really important. We have also programs partnering with ecosystem stakeholders to reach patients. And some of the things that is very interesting is when you are a patient, and this is a fact, and you are feeling that you need something with your pacemaker or your defibrillator, what you do if you cannot call the hospital, if you cannot call the clinical specialist that is treating you. So we pull all of them together, we create a different network for the patients who are able to call if they were able to reach a phone, to reach an 800 number when they have 24/7 people answering this phone and directing the patients to the appropriate locations when it was suitable to have the assistance that they needed. But we need to create a different network of the ones that were established in the island because all the communication in the island went down. So we create one here in Western. We have a backup also in Colombia. And we create these two networks in order for our patients to reach a 1-800 number, the ones that they were using before, and they can reach the help that they need. So, what's interesting, from other offices in BSC Latin America, there was an immediate sense of help. And they offer in different ways to help people, not only with ideas of how to send physicians, how to send supplies, how to send different things, and we did it. So, as a sample of this, we have a mission coming from Dallas, from Texas, an ex-Puerto Rican ex-employee that right now is working in BSC in Texas, was able to put together a couple of planes with doctors and other people that work in eight locations, eight remote towns in the island, providing support to thousands of people with medicine, with basic assistance, with everything during several days in the island. So this is the kind of help and solidarity that we were able to find in other places. So they did many things. They supply material, they supply support, they made medical assistance, etc. So, and also, we were thinking what we can do for the patient and the community in the island. And we came up with a program that all of you know that we have co-pays when you have an expensive treatment. And these co-pays in many cases are several thousand dollars because some devices and some treatments are really expensive. In this case, when you are having your house down, when you don't have a car, when you are in dire straits, probably many people were thinking, you know what, I'm not going to have my treatments. Rather than that, I'm going to keep my family in a better way, and I'm going to use this money to help my home. And in many cases, it costs the life of the patient. So when they say, that's not fair. So we were saying, if you qualify for this, we're going to waive your copay, and you can have the treatment that you need for a period of time. But we decided it was going to be 6 months, and we can prorogate that if we need it. So it was very well accepted by the community, by the doctors, by the hospitals, and even by the payers, because these kind of things help people really in the things that matter most in this moment. So as a result of that, we were able to have, in September, the month when the hurricane crashed, we have 43% of the number of patients that we reach every month. But it was clear, it was not because of us, it was clearly because the patients at the hospital were not able to reach the hospital. So 85% in October, 100% in November. So this shows you how we can really fast, we can recover of this situation if you pay attention to the basic things of the people, that is the first, the most important thing. As Maria mentioned, we didn't have any attrition so far. We are really, we have very grateful employees, but the most important is we were able to regain our capacity to attend the patients in the fastest way. So,
Maria went and she said, I'm going to fix, or she worked with a team to win to fix the plant, the manufacturing plant, so get all of our devices running. And we hadn't been able to fix the plant. And by the way, our competitors are also in the island, very close to our facility. If nobody had done anything, we would have had a big crisis. I remember John asking me, hey, Mauricio, have you contacted competitors or something to treat patients? And I said, yeah, we're doing that. The real thing is we're doing much better than anybody, and we were acting fast. So our competitors went to the island, actually had a big fight with the governor, asking for rights and asking for production. And what we did, we went to the governor and said, how can we help, sir? And we were doing this. That gave us a fast track to fix our plant. Unfortunately, that didn't, nothing happened with the plant, that we were okay with that. With our patients, by the way, Felipe is a doctor. So it was his number one priority. So that with that way, plant and people were able to get along with this crisis. What I'm going to show you right now is reality. When Mike Amoni, our CEO, came down to the island, and somebody got a microphone, and he just came in and he talked to the people on what he thought went well. So I want to show that video where he speaks. It was not a prepared speech, nothing like that. It came out from his heart, but I think it's meaningful. You know what the CEO thought about the crisis and how he acknowledged our employees. And afterwards, we will go to the lessons learned, which I think is the good, the bad, and the ugly of what we did or we didn't, how this group of guys were able to find a plane in Miami, how this was not UPS or FedEx or nothing like that, but probably a pretty old plane. I remember when Mike Mahoney, our CEO, told me, hey, where is it? Where are you finding this plane? I said, I don't know, Mike, we are finding them. I mean, we can get a place that I have. I said, I call some place in Colombia. I don't think that's a really good idea. but let me share with you guys what our CEO of the course he said when he reached the Puerto Rico. I'm going to go to the next slide.
Felipe said, again, I was staying. I said, just don't be a fool, just leave. But like,
my partners as well. I was dying in Dallas.
In Dallas.
So he went out trying to get rid of everyone.
And he got out and
his mouth. So his wife said, hey, we should have speech.
So we know, so I'm like, we're in the office, racist, we don't go to wicked home people, but we were beat. I think that day we went on Amazon, and Amazon would show batteries available for more than 10 minutes. Is he no longer available? And then Amazon said it was FEMA, and it didn't care, it didn't care for all emergency supplies. So I'm like, I'm going to bed buying in big bags of batteries. So we get to home people, and I'm like, Mauricio, D batteries are important. Would you go for D batteries?
And that's true. Actually, the lessons right here that are very important is everybody has to show leadership. You are the guys that pack it. And we are not Felipe. We need to put this in the corporate plane. And then we have to have double bags that simulate the real people.
Because my goal is to say, you guys have the plane, but please don't trash the plane. So you couldn't just put pallets on the plane. We had to put away double bags. The other thing is, where we were in the office, no internet means that if you go on Expedia, hotels will appear available. So it's like 10:30 at night, or it's just like, we've got to get that far because people, we're going to have control centers. So we're going to get a couple of hotels, get 10 rooms if we can. And he was processing, paying for two of these hotels. All the hotels were on the internet, so everything looked available, but there was not anything.
Yeah, that's important right here because I didn't feel like a hero at half my thing. I found all the people who were the room was too dry. And I don't know why I paid for it. I didn't get the money. But then when people went to the hotel, they said, do you have a reservation? I'm sorry, they were going to be from this. We don't want this. We don't want this. You thought that you were doing the best thing because you were booking hotels for this one moment.
The business continuity is one of those. UPS had put out many of the planes, so that's when we went to the charter. So we just sent for about 2 weeks in addition to the lumberjack, we're actually using a charter service.
Yeah, something about the hotels on the ICP testing because you are competing with the strongest and powerful public organization like FEMA. But we wanted to have the hotels were up and running. Immediately we saw that FEMA was 100% of the hotel. We didn't have any rooms available because FEMA was there. So it was all the time competing with the scarce resources that we have here.
I think from the lessons here is also the people that are not in the team of crisis management are the people who bring the best ideas. The crisis management that we placed was never. We know everything and nobody can walk through that door. Not everybody could go to any place and basically give their contributions. Actually, I will tell you that it was 2 o'clock at night when I went to the office and I went to the lawyer's place. And they said, what are you really needing? I said, you know, get me a plane. If you get me a plane, call me up. Next day, we got a plane. That it came from the crisis management team. The ideas we were in UPS, we were in FedEx, we were in Avianca, we were in the American Airlines cargo companies. The people that found us a plane was, I know somebody who has a plane before calling me. If we didn't have that, what was the hope that came?
So that's a very simple
thing. I don't know where we are, how we were tracking it. And normal place, it's 3 hours to Puerto Rico. This plane took 6 hours to Puerto Rico. Imagine the plane. And we hired the plane. And with that plane, we were able to get the manufacturing plant running outside of the box. And by the way, that plane helped other companies that we shared this good practice with them to also be able to run their manufacturing plants. So this company is in the newspapers in Miami. They are making their money. They have a lot of good customers with all kinds. They were the ones that were able to take us out. So it's not that common. And if FedEx UPS planes, nothing that will solve the crisis.
So talking about planes, we were in constant communication with our corporate aviation and our pilots. So the day
Thank you. have the most part of the thing is like that security and find some people to secure the facility. And I was proposed to that idea. I said, hey, we want this, we want extra security, we want this extra help. And finally, we gave all the security of the family structure. And in any case, we had people that wanted to get into a bar room or something, just let people in. We wouldn't be in any position to take people or get police or somebody not trying to get into the tent. We would let people in. We would never go and threaten people that were trying to find a better way of living there. And I will not show it, I would like to just, if somebody has any questions, and I know Mushka told me he had one project that he had adopted in Q3. I'm willing to put this last week in Q3 because I want to do that. But if somebody has any question on how we handle this crisis, or in the lessons, or in what we will do better or something, we're just open to questions. Great question. And for my Nobel Prize, while we were in this, my HR partner started to make calls where I saw calls with Mexico, calls with Chile, and calls with Argentina about crisis management. So from their own, they started to do this. So today we do have not only the path of hurricanes, but we're earthquakes. We have about crisis management team trained. We have already the satellite who is there. And we have the basic kits of, how do we call it, ready and food ready to be consumed. Food ready to be consumed. So we have all those kits in every location. And I always tell them, believe me when they tell you, let's participate in this drill, whatever it looks like, fire, whatever, participate, because that makes a difference in your life. That's a great question, and that question was actually asked to our CEO in one of our order. I don't know if there are people on this one, but this is a type of, and I will rephrase what he said. He said the island is very attractive for Muslims, and they have a print there. And now it's not about anymore about the taxes, it's about the people that we have trained. And this is very complex production. This is very complex what they do. And we will continue to be there. And actually, I got another question. And it's the part of account receivables. If hospitals are not paying, they are delaying their payments, will you shut them? Or what would you do? My answer will be exactly the same. I won't create more damage than Maria by not giving any support to the hospital system. So, yes, we will be there, and yes, we will continue to do some cash flow exercises to be able to provide the service.
Even in this pandemic, we expanded manufacturing by 43%, I mean, two more lines in macro simulation business units in Dorado. So we created another 400 jobs in the past quarter.
I will be very, very, I mean, I will answer you. It's easier for a company like us that is a big company and has cash. And I know that when you talk about identifying a plane, a corporate plane site, or being able to contract a plane on site, we're buying 1,000 it's easier for a company like us. The most important thing is the empowerment. So every person felt that it was empowered. I never got from my team any question on the members and didn't think the mosquito bites that you were buying by gallons is more cheap or not. We paid to the hotels in Puerto Rico water at incredibly prices, like if it were champagne, believe me. And people never thought it was about money. Fortunately, because we have a good cash flow and people are empowered. Now, for a company that doesn't have those resources, would it have been difficult? Yes, very difficult. But I can tell you that there are companies that have more cash than us, or richer than us. But go back to the values, because of the empowerment and for the willingness to save patients. But other companies talk about that only for their finance. The first part with them was before Maria hit the island, we got all the inventory and shipped it offshore. So we had, let's say, a good amount of inventory outside.
So how fast is your plan on your side? And how fast is your plan to assume that production? There's obviously a transition period. So from a scientific perspective, the pre-planning, our generators kick in immediately. We've got 10 days worth of generator fuel at all times. So we can take a look at that when we look at also from a total global planning perspective, what is knowing when that hurricane season's in the year, can we manage our inventory demand planning across the globe and adjust it? So we can take a look at that, but we need fuel and we have to adjust it.
I think that the audience and my father is here, so thank you very much for waking up.